Hello, I am Sapna Davis of ECE Department, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. Pattern recognition is an automated recognition of patterns. Consider the example of recognizing handwritten digits. Here every digit is a 28 by 28 pixel image. So it can be represented by a vector x of 784 real numbers. 28 times 28 is 784. A pattern recognition machine takes a vector x as the input and produces 0 to 9 as the output. In machine learning, a large set of n labeled digits is used to tune the parameters of an adaptive model. This set is called as a training set. The category or label of a digit is given by the target vector t, and there will be one target vector t for every image x. The result of ML algorithm is a function yx. The precise form of yx is obtained during the training phase or the learning phase using the training data. Once the model is trained, it can categorize new images. The ability to label correctly new inputs that differ from those used for training is known as generalization. The original inputs are generally transformed into some new space of variables. This pre-processing is called as a feature extraction. Next, we'll see different types of learning techniques. Supervised learning. If the training data consists of input vectors and the target vectors, then it is called a supervised learning. Second one is unsupervised learning. The training data consists of a set of input vectors without any corresponding target values. In such cases, we can discover the groups of similar input vectors within the data. This is called as clustering. Or we can find the distribution of the data within the input space. This is called as a density estimation. Next is a reinforcement learning. No desired category is given here. Instead, the only feedback is that the tentative category is right or wrong. Then we can discover the category by trial and error. And there is a sequence of states and actions in which the learning algorithm is interacting with its environment. There are classification problems as well as regression problems. In case of classification problems, every input vector is assigned to one of a finite number of discrete categories. Whereas in regression problems, the desired output consists of one or more continuous variables. Next, we'll see the applications of pattern recognition. First one is a machine vision. Captures the images via camera and analyzes them to produce descriptions of the images. And for example, it is used in manufacturing industry to categorize as a defective or non-defective. Next is a character recognition. Third one is a computer-aided diagnosis, assisting doctors in making diagnostic decisions. Next is a speech recognition. And the last one mentioned here is data mining and knowledge discovery. For machine perception, we build machines that can recognize patterns. And it can be used in automated speech recognition, fingerprint identification, optical character recognition, etc. To build such systems, we require deeper understanding and appreciation for pattern recognition systems in the natural world. Example, how we humans do the classification. Next is the block diagram of a pattern recognition system. The input is applied to the system. Then comes sensing, segmentation, feature extraction, classification, post-processing, and finally we get the decision. The input will be sensed with a transducer. Transducer converts one form of energy into another. For example, microphone is a transducer which will be converting sound energy to electrical energy. Next block is a segmentation. Segmentation will be separating the region of interest where the object is present, say for example. Then comes a feature extraction. Features are measurements having values. And these values will be very similar for objects in the same category. And these values will be very different for objects in different categories. And the features will be invariant to transformation of the input, such as a translation, rotation, and scaling. Then from the available features, the important features have to be selected. Classification means using the feature vector, the object will be assigned a category. Post-processing uses the output of the classifier to measure the performance, and based on that some action will be decided. The simplest measure of classifier performance is the error rate, and the action taken will minimize the error. Figure shows the design cycle of a pattern recognition system. First step is a data collection, then choosing the features, choosing the model, training the classifier, evaluation of the classifier. Data collection accounts for a large part of the cost. Then feature selection, choice of the features depends on the characteristic of the problem. Then model choice, the hypothesis model should approximate the true model. This can be done by trial and error. Then we have to train the classifier or training the base model we have chosen using the data. Then comes the evaluation of the classifier. This will be measuring the performance. In pattern recognition system, computational complexity means it is the labeling time needed and the storage requirements. And overfitting means a complex system may perfectly classify the training samples, but the performance may not be good with the new patterns. Next is a base theory and a classifier. Consider a two class or category problem. Let omega 1 and omega 2 are the two classes and x is an input vector. If p of omega 1 by x, which is the posteriori probability, is greater than p of omega 2 by x, x can be assigned to the class omega 1. Similarly, if p of omega 2 by x is greater than p of omega 1 by x, then omega 2 is the assigned class. Then the probability of error is given by p of error on x is equal to p of omega 1 by x when we are deciding for omega 2 and p of omega 2 by x when the decision is omega 1. The average probability of error can be obtained by integrating the joint probability of error and x with respect to x. Base decision rule for minimizing the probability of error is decide omega 1 if p of omega 1 by x is greater than p of omega 2 by x, otherwise decide for omega 2. Now probability of error on x will be equal to minimum of p of omega 1 by x and p of omega 2 by x. The posteriori probability p of omega j by x can be written in terms of the likelihood probability p of x on omega j and the priori probability p of omega j. And px in the equation is unimportant for making a decision and it's just a scaling factor. And also p of omega 1 by x plus p of omega 2 by x will be equal to 1. By eliminating the scale factor, the decision rule is decide for omega 1 if p of x on omega 1 times p of omega 1 greater than p of x on omega 2 times p of omega 2. Otherwise, decide for omega 2. If p of x on omega 1 equal to p of x on omega 2, then the decision is based on the priori probabilities p omega 1 and p of omega 2. If p of omega 1 equal to p of omega 2, then both the classes are equiprobable and the decision is based on the likelihood probability p of x on omega j. The feature vector x can be a scalar or d-dimensional vector in the feature space. And also, more than two classes are possible. The loss function states exactly how costly every action is and is used to convert a probability into a decision. Let omega 1 to omega c be the finite set of c classes and alpha 1 to alpha a be the finite set of possible actions. Action alpha I means assigning an input vector x to the class omega I, like that you can consider. Suppose we observe a particular input x and we take action alpha I. If the true class is omega j, loss for taking action alpha I is a lambda of alpha I on omega j. Expected loss associated with the action alpha I is r of alpha I on x equal to summation j equal to 1 to c lambda of alpha I on omega j multiplied by the posteriori probability. Expected loss is called as the risk and r of alpha I on x is called as the conditional risk. The overall risk is obtained by integrating the conditional risk, and to minimize the overall risk, compute the conditional risk and select the action alpha I for which the conditional risk is minimum. The resulting minimum overall risk is called as the base risk and it is giving the best performance. Two category classification. Let lambda ij equal to lambda of alpha I on omega j be the loss for deciding omega I when the true class is omega j. The conditional risk r of alpha 1 on x equal to lambda 1 1 p of omega 1 on x plus lambda 1 to p of omega 2 by x. Similarly, we can write the equation for r of alpha 2 on x. For minimizing the risk, decide omega 1 if r of alpha 1 on x less than r of alpha 2 on x. In terms of the posteriori probabilities, the same equation can be rewritten as lambda 21 minus lambda 11 times p of omega 1 on x greater than lambda 12 minus lambda 22 p of omega 2 by x. Here lambda 21 minus lambda 11 and lambda 12 minus lambda 22 are positive because loss for a wrong decision is always greater than that of a correct decision. The same equation can be rewritten in terms of the likelihood probabilities and the priori probabilities. On simplification, we get the final equation like this, where p of x on omega 1 division p of x on omega 2 is called as the likelihood ratio. Minimum error rate classification. The decision rule always minimizes the probability of error or error rate. If action alpha is taken and the true class is omega j, then the decision is correct if I equal to j and is in error if I not equal to j. The loss function for a C-class problem can be given by zero loss for a correct decision and unity loss for a wrong decision. Then all errors are equal costly. The risk corresponding to this loss function can be simplified to 1 minus p of omega I on x, where p of omega I on x is the conditional probability that action alpha I is correct. To minimize the risk, we have to select omega I, that will be maximizing the posterior probability of omega I on x. Hence, for minimum error rate, decide omega I if p of omega I on x greater than p of omega j on x for all j not equal to I. Figure shows the plot of the likelihood ratio p of x on omega 1 division p of x on omega 2. This ratio can range between 0 and infinity. The region in the infinite space where we decide omega I is denoted as Ri. The threshold theta A is obtained with a 0-1 loss function. And if lambda 21 greater than lambda 12, then we get the threshold theta B. Minimax criterion. Sometimes we design classifiers to perform well over a range of priori probabilities. That is, we minimize the maximum possible overall risk. Let R1 be the region in feature space where the classifier decides for omega 1 and R2 be the region where the classifier decides for omega 2. Then the overall risk is given by the summation of the integral of R of alpha 1 on x over the region R1 and the integral of R of alpha 2 on x over the region R2. Simplify the equation, and once the decision boundary between R1 and R2 is set, the overall risk is a linear function of P of omega 1. If we can find a boundary such that the constant of proportionality is 0, then the risk is independent of the priori probabilities, and this is the minimax solution, and it is given by the first term of the equation. The curve shows the minimum error as a function of P of omega 1. In case of a two-class category problem, the approach searches for the priori probability for which the base risk is maximum and the corresponding decision boundary gives the minimax solution. For each value of the priori probabilities, we can find an optimal decision boundary. For any such boundary, the probability of error will change as a linear function of P of omega 1. It is shown for a p of omega 1 equal to 0.25 with a maximum at a p of omega 1 equal to 1. To minimize the maximum of such error, find decision boundary for the maximum base error p of omega 1 equal to 0.6, and thus the error will not change as a function of the priori probability as shown by the red horizontal line. Neyman-Pearson criterion. In some problems, we like to minimize the overall risk subject to a constraint. Say minimize the total risk subject to the constraint integral of conditional risk less than a constant for some particular I. Such a constraint may arise when misclassification of patterns from a particular class is more risky. Example, more than 1% of a malignant lesion should not be misclassified as benign. This criterion can be satisfied by adjusting the decision boundaries numerically.